thank you so much. That was a lovely welcome. Praise God. Are we feeling blessed, saints?
Yes.
Oh, I am truly feeling blessed, and it's good to be home. I know we've got some visitors that have just come in. Welcome. We pray that you will be truly blessed and that you will enjoy this as we worship God. Okay, let us bow our heads, shall we? Dear Father, we thank you so much for your goodness and mercies towards us. What a wonderful Sabbath. Lord, from the lips of babes, you have called forth praise. And how wonderful this has been. And so, dear Father, I pray that you will speak through me one more time. As we pause to look at your word and meditate on it, speak to us. For we love to hear your sweet voice. In Jesus' holy name.
Amen.
There was five of them, and they were making their way to their destination, and they were in a rush. They were five beautiful young ladies, and the ladies amongst us will know that to look good takes time. They had carefully decided on what hairstyle they would have. They decided on what outfit they would wear, and when they left the house, they looked amazing. They were now walking with determined steps. They were looking forward to having a wonderful time. They knew that the food was going to be good and it was going to be absolutely great. In fact, they had counted down the weeks, the days, the weeks, and they were looked forward to this day with great anticipation. They were almost at their destination. Their lamps were burning bright, and then they knocked at the door. As they knocked at the door was opened, and it was the groom that looked out. And they looked expectantly, expecting for the door to swing wide open and to be shown the way in. To their surprise, in fact, to their horror, the groom looked at them quizzically and said to them, "Of a truth, I do not know you." But then they looked at, surely something has gone wrong. We've been looking forward to this day for how long? How can you not know us? In fact, five had already been admitted. But these were the five that had required extra oil. It's a question of identity. For as the groom looks out at the five foolish virgins, he says, "I do not know you." And so, children, the question today is, who are we? Our title for today's sermon is Children of God. I don't know if we have the PowerPoint there, please. Children of God. Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Can you say those names, children? Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Adults, can you help them, please? They're a little timid this morning. Daniel, Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. Over and over and over again, they were having to answer this question. And so by the time we get to Daniel chapter 3, there's something of a climax for three of them. Yes? Daniel is not present, but there is Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. And so turn with me, if you would, to Daniel chapter 3. And I'm going to start at verse 1. If we can move it forward, please, to the image. It says here in verse 1, King Nebuchadnezzar made an image of gold, 60 cubits high and 6 cubits wide, and set it up on the plain of Jura in the province of Babylon. King Nebuchadnezzar, in Daniel chapter 2, had received a dream. And none of the wise men were able to interpret that dream or even reveal what the dream was. But God miraculously revealed it to Daniel. when he and his friends had a prayer meeting and pleaded with God, and he was able to reveal the dream and also the interpretation, next slide please, to the king Nebuchadnezzar. And King Nebuchadnezzar was amazed and was able to reward him. And you know, one thing that Daniel said was that the head of gold was none other than Nebuchadnezzar. But it was going to be followed by the kingdom, the chest of silver. Nebuchadnezzar didn't like that. And then the thighs of bronze, and the legs of iron, and the feet of iron and clay. Nebuchadnezzar was pleased that God had seen fit to interpret the vision, the dream that he had to him. But Nebuchadnezzar was troubled, brethren. He was troubled because in his mind, he never wanted Babylon to ever pass away. And so as he was thinking about it, he was thinking up a plan that would ensure that Babylon, the head of gold, would reign forever. In fact, Daniel tells us that there's a power that would seek to change times and laws. We're seeing it here tonight. King Nebuchadnezzar decided that he would make an image, not of the different metals that he had seen. It would be total gold from head to foot. Nebuchadnezzar would reign supreme. Babylon would reign supreme forever. And it was quite an amazing plan. In fact, let me read on in verses 2. Daniel 3, verse 2. He says, then he summoned the satraps, the prefects, the governors, the advisors, treasurers, judges, magistrates, and all the other provincial officials to come to the dedication of the image that he had set up. So the satraps, prefects, governors, advisors, treasurers, judges, magistrates, and all the other provincial officials assembled for the dedication of the image that King Nebuchadnezzar had set up, and they stood before it. These were the people that had the power to actually undermine the kingdom and cause it to fall. And so in his wisdom, King Nebuchadnezzar summoned the lot of them and said, listen, you're going to come today and we're going to have worship. That sound all right? Yeah. We're going to have worship. And he began to instruct them as to what they would do in that place. Verse 4. Then the herald loudly proclaimed, nations and peoples of every language, this is what you are commanded to do. As soon as you hear the sound of the horn, the flute, the zither, the lyre, the harp, the pipe, and all kinds of music, you must fall down and worship the image of gold that King Nebuchadnezzar has set up. Whoever does not fall down and worship will immediately be thrown into a blazing furnace. King Nebuchadnezzar set up an image of gold. And everyone was there. Daniel wasn't there, but his friends were. And the question that they had to ask themselves that day is, would they bow down and worship the image? Or would they remain standing and most certainly die? You think that? Children, I like that. You're thinking, right? And so the question, young people, is this. You may not be asked to worship an image, but when you go to school and when you're with your friends, the question is asked, are you? Because sometimes your friends would like to encourage you to do that which you know you should not do. Is it true? Some of them would encourage you to lie. Mom and dad do not need to know. It's our little secret. We do what we want. We make our rules. You know, more and more, I'm amazed. Because as children, you know your rights. When we were growing up, we were told what to do. And if we didn't do it, there would be some recompense. Yes? There would be some kind of punishment. Yes? Right? Now, what has happened, I think it is very good that you do have your rights, right? But the question is, in the decisions that you make, what is it saying about you? I remember there was a story of a young man, one of my churches, one of the young men shared it. He went to a school and he wanted to fit in so much that when his friends said to him, "Why don't you take some drugs?" Because they were taking it, and he wanted to fit in, what do you think he did? He took the drugs. Yeah? And messed up his life. Right? Bad decisions. Right? The decisions that we make each day are saying something about us.
Oh, yeah.
Right? And the world is looking on. And they're reading our lives like an open storybook.
Oh, yes.
Yeah? Well, these young men were there. I don't know if we can move the slides forward. They were there to the music notes. And you know what happened? The music began to play. It was an orchestra that had so many different instruments, and the music began to play, and all the people, what do you think the people were beginning to do? The people began to bow. And as King Nebuchadnezzar looked over the throng of people, he must have rejoiced to know that his great plan was actually coming to realize it was actually being fulfilled. He could save his kingdom. Do you think they bowed?
No.
Well, verse 8 tells us, at this time, some astrologers came forward and denounced the Jews. They said to King Nebuchadnezzar, "May the king live forever. Your majesty has issued a decree that everyone who hears the sound of the horn, the flute, the zither, the lyre, the harp, the pipe, and all kinds of music must fall down and worship the image of gold. And that whoever does not fall down and worship will be thrown into a blazing furnace." Verse 12. But there are some Jews whom you have set over the province or over the affairs of the province of Babylon, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, who pay no attention to you, your majesty. They neither serve your gods nor worship the image of gold you have set up. Can we scroll that forward? I don't know if I'm having a problem with the three young men that were standing up. Yeah? The king was absolutely furious. How dare they ruin the plan? The three young men are summoned before the king. But the question I want to ask children is, why did they do it? Say it a bit louder. Because they believe in God? Right? Any other reason? Pardon? They're faithful? Very good. I want to share this with you. I'm sure that their parents taught them this. Right? And it's found in Exodus chapter 20, reading from verse 1. It says, "And God spoke all these words. I am the Lord your God, who brought you out of Egypt, out of the land of slavery. You shall have no other gods before me." How many?
No.
No other gods before me. You shall not make for yourself an image in the form of anything in heaven above, or in the earth beneath, or in the waters below. You shall not bow down at or worship them. For I, the Lord your God, am a jealous God, punishing the children for the sins of the parents to the third and fourth generation of those who hate me, but showing love to 1,000 generations of those who love me and keep my commandments. Oh, they were standing before the most powerful king of their time. And the king had said to them, you bow down or lose your life. But children, God was speaking to them. And as they were listening to the king, they recognized that there was someone that was far more greater than the king. In fact, so great that he actually gave the king life.
All right.
Recognize him? He actually created the king. And if he should stop supplying him with bread, he would die. And so they looked at it and they said, you know what? We serve the true and the living God. And if we must go into the flames of fire, we will not bow down and worship this image that the king has set up. This is what it says, verse 13. Furious with rage, Nebuchadnezzar summoned Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. So these men were brought before the king, and Nebuchadnezzar said to them, is it true, Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, that you do not serve my gods or worship the image of gold I have set up? Now, when you hear the sound of the horn, the flute, zither, lyre, harp, pipe, and all kinds of music, if you are ready to fall down and worship the image I have made, very good. But if you do not worship it, you will be thrown immediately into a blazing furnace. Then what God will be able to rescue you from my hand? That's a challenge, eh? Right? Nebuchadnezzar felt a little sorry for them. And so he said, listen, I will give you a second chance. Do you think that was kind? He did. Do you think they would take it?
No.
No? Well. Well, this is what they had to say. And I pray to God that you will be so bold in your lives when the devil is trying to tempt you and lead you astray. This is what they said. If we are thrown into the blazing furnace, verse 17, the God we serve is able to deliver us from it. Mm-hmm. And he will deliver us from your hand, your majesty's hand. But if he does not, we want you to know, your majesty, that we will not serve your gods or worship the image of gold you have set up.
All right.
Praise God.
All right.
Praise God for Hananiah, Mishael, and Azariah. I can imagine that as the king is speaking to them, they stand tall. Yeah. Sorry, your majesty, but we don't need a second chance.
No.
You see, we know in whom we believe.
Amen.
Our God, we love him so much that we wouldn't even force his hands. You see, our decision is based upon who he is. And we want you to know that he can save us from those flames.
Amen.
You want to scare us? There is someone greater than who you are. And he's the one that we will remain faithful to. And even if he permits us to die in the flames, let it be known that we are children of God.
Amen.
Oh, children, the question is, how could they make such a decision? You see, the furnace was blazing, the flames were there. The smell filled the air. How could they do it? I'd like to suggest to you, I don't know if we can get the slide. They were there on the plain of Jura, and the image was there, and the flames were lapping, and the threat of death was hanging over them, they said, you know what? You can take the whole world, but give me Jesus. Amen. You can take the whole wide world and all it has to offer because I want my Jesus. Huh? And so the question today, children, is this. Who will you choose? Huh? They were able to say, we are children of God.
All right.
A children of God by name and children of God by nature. And we each and every day will choose God.
Amen.
Isn't that amazing? Children of God. Well, the sad reality is this, children. Were they spared the flames?
No.
Now let me read it. It says here, verse 20. Verse 19, but Nebuchadnezzar was furious with Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego, and his attitude towards them changed. He ordered the furnace heated 7 times hotter than usual. The command, and commanded some of the strongest soldiers in the army to tie up Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego and throw them into the blazing furnace. So these men, wearing their robes and trousers and turbans and other clothes, were bound and thrown into the blazing furnace. The king's command was so urgent and the furnace so hot that the flames of the fire killed the soldiers who took Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. And these three men, firmly tied, fell into the blazing furnace. And the king must have just rubbed his hand, looked at the crowd, and thought to himself, it's all over. Everyone will have learned their lesson, but children, let it be known to you that when you stand up for God, He stands up for you. The whole world may reject you, but you know what? He will embrace you. He will be with you. What happened was, although they fell into the flames, there was someone there that was able to pick them up. Do you know who it was? Jesus. Amen. So I want you to know today that it doesn't matter what troubles you may face. We know as your parents that sometimes you face troubles. We understand about bullying at school. We understand about sometimes the stresses that you feel and you feel that you cannot cope. We understand that. But we want you to know today that God is with you in the good times and He'll always be with you in the difficult times.
Amen.
And He will make a way for you. Well, this is what it says, verse 24. The king Nebuchadnezzar leapt to his feet in amazement. And he asked his advisors, weren't there three men that we tied and threw into the fire?
Yes.
They replied, certainly, your majesty. He said, look, I see 4 men walking around in the fire, unbound and unharmed, and the 4th one looked like the son of the gods.
Amen.
The king was so excited that he ordered that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego come out of the flames. And as they came out of the flames, children, that everyone came and gathered around them and touched them and smelled them and saw that they were totally unharmed. And the king, who wanted to destroy them, ordered that everyone praise the God of Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego. What can we learn from that, children? It's a very important lesson. It's often in the difficult times that God is able to shine brightest through us.
Amen.
Huh? Because it's in the difficult times that people say, why do they hold on? Well, why go through all this trouble? But as they looked at the God that Shadrach, Meshach, and Abednego were serving, they had to conclude that this was a true and the living God. And so the question, dear children, is this. Are you children of the King? Are you children of God? God is looking for more Hananiahs, Mishaels, and Azariahs to stand in our times.
Amen.
More Esthers. Yes? And the question, children, is this. Would you like to say yes to God today? Yes, God, you can take my life. Yes, I want to shine for you. Yeah? Yes, Lord, I want to serve you. If you would like to say yes, I want to ask you if you would stand. And I'll pray for you. We'll pray for you. Children, stand. If you'd like to have God in your life, hey, be brave. Don't look around. You stand on your own. You make your own. That's it. Good. Brave. You don't have to wait for anyone else. It's your own decision. Yeah? You stand for God. Don't be ashamed. Yeah? Because I tell you something, you will be the children that will cause people to turn around and say, surely there is a God. Yeah. And so, parents, we're going to ask you this. We're going to ask Pastor Nicholson to come and do a special prayer. But I'm going to ask for parents or guardians to come. Just lay your hands on all the children, those who are standing, those who are sitting. Just lay your hands on the children. We'd like to dedicate them to God afresh. You can move quickly, yeah? It can be grandparents, parents, whoever you are, guardians. Please come and lay your hands on your children so we can have a special prayer for them at this time. Praise God. We can sing that song. Could that chorus, Into My Heart?
Into my heart, into my heart.
Still two children here who have no one to stand with them. Okay, good. Let us pray. Father, these are your children. You have simply given them to us as caretakers. We pray now, having dedicated to them as infants, and as they come to this age of accountability where they are discovering you for themselves, that they may make a decision to give their hearts to you. Help them to know that they cannot wait until the fire is burning to choose you, but like Daniel and his friends, to decide ahead of time that they will not eat the king's food. They will choose ahead of time that they will give themselves to you and be loyal to you and follow you for all of their lives. Father, there are so many voices calling you. There are so many things to distract them. Lord, may we as parents, may we as leaders in our church, may we build a fence of love around them. May we build a fence of prayer around them. May we sustain and encourage them to remain true to you. May they catch a vision of the fact that you died for them. You love them. You want the best for them. May they see that Satan is a liar and his plans is to corrupt, to deceive, to destroy, and to rob them of eternal lives. So now, Lord, even now, as you speak to their hearts, may they hear you saying, my son, my daughter, give me your heart, and I will give you my Father's kingdom. And may every one of them say, Lord, just as I am, I give my life to you. Just as I am, I give my future to you. Oh Lord, may they feel the joy and peace that comes from knowing that there is great joy in being on your side. So may the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May the Lord preserve you. May the Lord make you proud to be his son and daughter. May you not be ashamed of him. May you stand firm before your friends, before family, before the community, and let the light of Jesus shine through you now and always. Let the church say,
Amen. Amen.
Praise God. Praise God. For our visitors, as we prepare to sing our next part of our next hymn, I just want to let you know that our God loves all of his children. The reality is, we're looking at the young ones today, but God loves all of his children, whatever age we are. And John 3:16 tells us what says. Can we say that together? For God so loved the world, that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him, he shall not perish, but have everlasting life. And so that invitation goes to everyone here. It's never too late to embrace God, because to embrace him is to have life. God bless you.
Amen.
Dear Father, we thank you.